Our Heavenly Father, who calls us your children and pours out upon us your grace and your power in the Holy Spirit, we come as followers of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, offering our lives into his service and offering these gifts as well, giving them with our thanks and with our joy, praying for your continued blessings in his name. Amen. You may be seated. Now, since not everyone was here last week, some were trapped in by ice or cold or for some other reason, you may have missed that we started a new sermon series. And the series is called The Great Invitation. It's based upon the fact that when Jesus calls someone, the invitation is a great one, and yet very simple at the same time. Follow me. That's the invitation he gives. And we are exploring what it means for us to accept that invitation and also to offer that invitation to others in his name. I think maybe the hardest part, though, of offering it to others is explaining the why of it all. Because sometimes you just don't think about it. But someone asks you, why are you a Christian? Or why are you a Methodist? Or why do you choose to follow Jesus? And we need to have those answers. In his great book on evangelism called Catch, Adam Hamilton says that if we want people to follow Jesus, we have to understand for ourselves why we do. And in order to do that, we have to be prepared to answer three questions. They're simple questions, but they're also deep questions. And the first is, why do people need Jesus? The second is, why do people need the church? And then the last is, why do people need our church? Now, you might answer those questions differently than I would. But I can tell you that I follow Jesus because I find in him the fulfillment of the deepest longings of the human heart. And in Jesus, I think he is also the solution for the most serious problems that plague our society, our world. And a lot of people might get that. They might get that Jesus is the Son of God and they believe in him, but they don't make that connection between Jesus and the church. Because there's a lot of people who like Jesus, but don't necessarily like the church. However, Jesus instituted the church and gave the church the authority to be his ongoing presence in the world. And for better or for worse, the church is the means that Jesus chose. And following him means joining together with others in the body of Christ. But then, why our church? Why St. Paul's and not some other one? Well, I would say because St. Paul's is the warmest, most welcoming congregation that I have ever served. And not only that, but we are committed to helping you discover not only what God has for you, but what God has you for. What your purpose is, and that we are committed to being a positive force for transformation here in our community and around the world. So that's how I would answer those three questions, and I want you to think about how you would. However, for a good number of people, you can have the answers, and you can explain it all until you're blue in the face, and they still won't get it, because some people aren't going to get it until they experience it for themselves. And that's why the model that Jesus presents for us in today's scripture is so compelling. And we find it in the first chapter of John, starting with verse 29. The next day, he, John the Baptist, saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, after me comes a man who ranks ahead of me, because he was before me. I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John testified, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, he on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples. And as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, look, here is the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, what are you looking for? They said to him, Rabbi, which translated means teacher, where are you staying? He said to them, come and see. They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, we have found the Messiah, which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas, which is translated Peter. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I'm curious, just by a show of hands, how many of you first came to St. Paul's because someone invited you to come here? I mean, raise them high. Okay. That's actually a much lower percentage than most places. But St. Paul's is a little different, aren't we? I think part of that is because we live on an island and people move to live here and then they start looking for a church. Whereas if you're in a place where you've lived for a long time, you kind of know where the churches are and people, you tend to go where people invite you. But in general, about 80 to 85% of people come to church for the first time because someone invited them. And if you think about it, that is the primary way that most of us came to know Jesus in the first place. There are some people who have these incredible stories of a direct encounter from Jesus that happened outside of anyone else talking about him first. But those stories are so incredible because they're so rare, right? And you might also hear stories of someone who joins in with some kind of hands-on work that's related to Jesus first. And then through that work, they started to believe. And then they decided to follow Jesus. For most of us, though, we got to Jesus first because someone we trusted, maybe our parents or friends, it could have been a coach or a teacher, someone told us about him. In other words, the way that most people get to Jesus is by referral. The way that John in today's scripture referred his disciples to Jesus. Now, they came to Jesus by this referral. And if you look at the passage, you'll notice that Jesus did two things. Two things that I think are critical to our understanding of the great invitation. And the first thing is that Jesus asked them what they were looking for. He asked them what they were seeking. When we invite others to follow Christ alongside of us and to take part in the life of the church, and they are actually interested, do we ask this question? Do we bother to ask them what they are seeking? Or do we presume to know already? Too often, efforts to share the good news with people have employed the tactic of telling people what they need and then explaining why Jesus is the answer to that need. However, remember what I said earlier. Jesus is the fulfillment of the deepest longings of the human heart. And not every human heart is the same. Yes, Jesus is still the answer. But the way that each of us approach the question then will be different, because people are unique. They have their own unique questions. They have their own personal experiences. As we share Jesus, do we recognize that? Because Jesus did. Jesus did. Although he knew all things on earth and in heaven, he knew all things, he took the time to ask them what they were seeking. Because it was important for them to be able to give voice to that, to figure it out for themselves. How do we ask the people we refer to Jesus what they're looking for? It's vital because their answer reveals their motives. And Jesus cares about motives. Jesus cares about the why of things. When John's disciples left John's side and came to Jesus, he asked them what they were seeking, and their response revealed why. Where are you staying? They asked him. Now, this question is more than what it sounds like. It's more involved than just something like, what neighborhood do you live in? Or what house is yours? See, in their model of discipleship, pupils didn't just follow their leader. Pupils lived life with their teacher. So what they were asking when they were asking, where do you live, was something more akin to, we're interested in the possibility of joining up with you and living the life that you live. Can we check that out? So, after asking them what they were seeking and understanding what they were longing for, Jesus didn't just give them all the answers, right? He had the answers, but he didn't just give them. He simply offers this invitation. Come and see. Come and see. He didn't say, that house over there is where I'm staying. Like he was being coy about whether or not he really understood their question. He didn't say, sign up for the rest of your lives right now on the spot, like I've seen some preachers do. No, he just said, come and see. Come along. And this illustrates something. Jesus didn't just give them directions. Jesus walked with them, which is what he calls us to do as well. We don't just tell people where to go. We walk with them along that journey. Jesus took them there where he was staying. Jesus spent time with them. He invested in them. And he let them get to know him and who he was and what he was about. That second part of the invitation, come and see, that part C, indicates that Jesus intended to open their eyes and allow them room to make their own decisions about what their next steps would be. They might come and stay after Jesus showed him all that he had to show them. And they might not, but the invitation was still open. Come and see. One of my favorite illustrations of this comes from a guy named Shane Claiborne. Now, Shane's active in the New Monastic Movement, which is where followers of Christ live together in close covenant communities. But instead of living far away from people, they intentionally move into neglected neighborhoods. And they seek to transform the lives of the people in those neighborhoods and the communities around them. But back when Shane was searching for direction in his life, he thought that it would be a good idea to go and visit and spend some time with the Missionaries of Charity in Calcutta, India. Now that is Mother Teresa's mission. So he wants to find out how to get there and what he's supposed to do. So he calls the place. And when the phone is picked up, he's surprised that it's not a secretary or a volunteer that answers the phone, but Mother Teresa herself. And this is what he tells about the conversation. I told her I had written and wanted to come work with her. She asked how long we wanted to stay, and I told her we would like to spend the summer, about 2 to 3 months. That's a long time, she said. And I shot back, 2 to 3 weeks, or 2 to 3 days. And he was thinking to himself, heck, 2 to 3 hours seemed nice. She said, no, come for the summer. Come. Where would we eat and sleep? So I asked her, Mother Teresa, where would we eat and sleep? She didn't worry a lot about that. She said, God takes care of the lilies and the sparrows, and God will take care of you. Just come. Who am I to argue with that? I thanked her and we hung up. Whenever folks ask Mother Teresa about her work in Calcutta, how it was going, what life was like, she would say, come and see. How do we invite people to come and see? In the scripture today, the story shows a very patient Jesus, a rabbi who allows for the fact that some of those who sought after him needed an extended period of time in his presence in order to really become his followers. Now, you'll see in other places of the Bible that some of the disciples hear Jesus call them, and they immediately just drop everything they're doing and run after him and follow him. But here it's different. In this story, we see an investment by Jesus in a relationship before the men made the decision to follow Jesus. And I think that illustrates a great truth about the great invitation. It is not one size fits all. Sometimes people need a little time. Sometimes people need a lot of time, right? Especially in a post-Christian society where it's much easier to live life as a skeptic than it is to live life as a person of faith. It may take some real experience of spending time in the presence of the Lord. And we need to be patient with people, loving them enough to not only give the invitation, but to also give them the time and space they need to respond to that invitation. But here's the question for those of us who are already following Jesus. How much time do you spend in the presence of the Lord? Learning about him, learning from him. How does that happen? What does it look like? And if you're spending time in the presence of Jesus, what happens in your life as a result of that? Is today's scripture a story you can relate to because you have also had the experience of remaining with him for an extended period of time? These are important questions, questions that we need to ask ourselves, questions that we need to be able to answer. Why? So we can extend that wonderful invitation to others, that invitation to come and see. Come and see what following the Lord has to offer. Let us pray. We come into your presence, dear Lord, knowing that you are always present, but we are not always present to you. Our hearts and minds become tangled up and occupied with other things, and we take your presence for granted. We don't learn from you as we should. Forgive us. And draw us closer and closer into a faithful discipleship where we live the life you lived, where we have a heart for those for whom you have a heart. And that when we offer an invitation, it will be the invitation that you offered to come and see, experience for yourself the beauty, the life of Christian discipleship. And may our lives reflect that beauty in all that we say and all that we do. In your holy name. Amen. Amen. As we stand.